want to welcome everybody here to the, this will be the fifth webinar we've done, but really the fourth one in the topic of professional selling. And again, for those of you who have not been on here, just do a brief overview and introduction to this. This is what we call the Better 52 webinar series, and this is really a commitment that we made for to 52 weeks of offering value to those of you to bring awareness to what we're doing with Better Loan Officers, but also to follow our passion of really helping mortgage professionals be better at what they do. And so each month we're going to be covering a new topic, and we're going to be going deep into that the second week of each topic. First week we're going to be doing an overview of the topic. Second week we're going to be doing a specific tool. This month was getting real with referral partners and slowing down for yellow lights. Third week we do an industry overview. This month we did with Greg Frost. And fourth week we're going to be tying it all together. And so that's what we're here today. So just a really brief overview of what we're doing in BetterLoanOfficers.com. Again, we were founded in 2003. We're a review management software focused solely on the mortgage industry, where you can search, find, and review any licensed mortgage originator in the country. We have powerful tools for reputation marketing, a robust company portal, and currently we are the largest directory of loan officers in the country with over 500,000 profiles. So we deliver value to three clients for consumers, where they can find loan officers like yourself, real estate agents, also to find loan officers to work with, but also to see who's on the other end of the transaction, and loan officers, of course, to manage and market your reputation, and for mortgage companies to manage the cumulative reputation of their organization. The team, the people here on the phone, you heard Brian briefly, he's our director of digital, and going to be one of the people you'll be communicating with if you have questions, and of course, myself, you'll be hearing a lot from today. The vision at Better Loan Officers is very simple. We are our goal is to be the voice and the currency of trust in the industry, especially around this symbol here. We're doing a lot to really give loan officers the tools to be successful. And when we look at our mission, it's to provide tools that give loan officers a voice that conveys trust and professionalism. And you'll see that happen in what our online tool provides, which I'll go into briefly at the end of this. So when we look at this concept of alignment, and I think we're all here, we want to be professional, we want to be better at what we do, we want to sell more, and we set out and we put goals that take us in a certain direction. And those goals, and I think everybody here on this phone, on this webinar, has gone through some sort of goal setting, but I think we've all felt the feeling of feeling very disorganized and very misaligned internally, for some reason having a hard time reaching those goals. And so when we look at this Better 52, we're looking at also setting those goals and going in a certain direction, but trying to align all of the skill sets that are needed to achieve those goals. And that's what really the Better 52 mission is about in a visual standpoint. So I gave you an overview of what the structure would look like, but today is what we're calling the resurgence of a sales professional. And I'm going to be going through 8 of the biggest challenges I see with the industry as a sales professional. And this is really around my purpose around bringing pride, integrity, and passion back to this lost art of selling. I started selling when I was 18 years old, and I was cut from my sophomore basketball team in college. It was one of the most devastating events of my life. And when I got a chance to ask a CEO of a very, very large company what I had to do to be in his shoes when he got older, he looked at me and smiled, and he said, "Rene, you learn how to sell. If you learn how to sell, you will always be employed." And I took that to heart. I was recruited to sell cookware door-to-door, and it was by far the biggest, most life-changing decision I'd ever made, because it got me the confidence. It taught me how to speak in front of people. It taught me the art of persuasion. It got me involved and surrounded by people that were into motivation and self-help and personal development. And it really got me to think about the reality. As in basketball, I could be really as good as my coaches would allow me to be, but in sales, I could be as good as I would allow myself to be. That was one thing that when I realized that, I never looked back. And I remember when I got involved in the mortgage industry back in the early 2000s, and I was talking to a friend of mine who owned a mortgage company, and I said, "Hey, it looks like interest rates are low. I just lost a $1 million client in the consulting business that we had right after 9/11, and I didn't know if I was going to be able to feed my family. I didn't know what we were going to do." And so I called him. I said, "Why don't you let me sell for a little bit, and until we figure out what's going on." He had 60 loan officers at the time, and I realized at that point that none of them were trained in how to sell, not a single one. This was right in the heart of the refi boom. People would literally fax out. I remember we were doing fax machines back then, applications. They come back the next day with all of them signed. I mean, it really was something that I believe killed sales professionalism for the mortgage industry. And I'm not saying there's anything wrong with that. I mean, jumping into easy business and easy money, fantastic. And back then it was easy money. It was also no barrier to entry. You had more qualifications that you had to pass to cut someone's hair than you did to deal with someone's mortgage. And so we all know where that ended and where that led to. And so the challenge with that is it also made it very difficult for professionals. Now that those who are left over in the industry, you're left to deal with the tainted reputation of what some of those in the past had done. And so this is about bringing pride, integrity, and professionalism back. And so I'm going to cover today specifically 8 topics. And in those 8 topics were really some of my frustrations. And I always look to some of my frustrations as inspiration for what can we do. And I structured this presentation very differently as well, where there's going to be a little bit more text in here, because a lot of people always ask for what is it was said. And we do record all of these, so you will be able to go back to our website and under the webinar section, and you'll be able to see those. I know Brian's been working diligently on getting those up. It's since we're doing one a week, it's a lot of work to get those things up, but he's been plowing away at that. So again, the 8 really around some of my frustrations, but really want to turn those frustrations into what can we put in terms of solutions. And so first one I want to cover is this concept of using marketing as a cop-out to selling. And I know I use harsh language like that for a reason. There is a big difference between what marketing is and what sales is. But what I have found is that sales requires us to get into people's face, and we're going to deal with rejection. And I found too many people use marketing as a way of not going out and selling. And they're doing all of the activities that get them away from being face-to-face with a customer. And so when we look at this, marketing and selling are both absolutely necessary to build successful businesses, but you have to understand that there's a difference. There's a big, big difference between them. And so we look at the reality of, you know, struggling salespeople. They tend to prefer marketing because it's a simple fact that it reduces the amount of rejection you're going to need to face. You can send out a letter, and if somebody tears it up, you have no idea what's going on. You have no idea. Sales, if you make a sales call, you walk into a realtor's office and they tell you to get out of there, then all of a sudden now you have to deal with that. But I go back to this, is that both of these are absolutely necessary, and there's some great, great marketing tools out there, and I suggest that we use every single one of them. In fact, we offer a ton of them. But it's not. Don't use it as a cop-out to getting face-to-face. So when I look at marketing in its simplest explanation, it really is about attracting people to call you, while selling forces you to call people. And of course, that also you risk rejection. So I want you to think about your daily activity and how much of it is really spent face-to-face. How much are you risking getting rejected? Are you looking at sending emails versus making a phone call? Do you have what we call telephobia? Are you looking for ways to reduce the amount of FaceTime? And sometimes, here's the challenge, this is unconscious. It's not something that you're doing on purpose. And so this isn't a judgment by any means. And the reality is nobody likes rejection. I don't like rejection. And I remember being told when I was first got into sales that don't take it personal, Rene. And in fact, they said, you know, even before that, they said, hey, we want you to get passionate about an idea, about a concept, and we want you to tell everybody that you know about it. And oh, by the way, most people are going to tell you no. But don't take that personal. That never resonated with me, because how are you going to ask me to take some and become passionate and believe in something, and when someone else doesn't like it, then how am I not supposed to take that personal? And what I came to realize is that it's the best salespeople, it's not that they don't take it personal. In fact, they take it very personal, but they know how to cope with that rejection. They don't let that rejection turn into a fear or a lack of action and paralysis, if you will. They look at that passion over what they have, and they see it as an obligation to go out and they talk to people. And the other reason why I don't like marketing to be used as a cop-out to selling is because you lose a lot of control. And if you're like me, the need for control is very high. And I'm not saying that I'm controlling. And if I were to ask the room, and I've asked this of salespeople, tens of thousands of them, and I said, how many of you have a high need for control? It doesn't mean you're controlling, but have a high need for control. And most people raise their hands. If you're in a group of people right now, look around and you probably see some smiles. And the reason that you need control is because you have traded a salary for a commission. That means that you said, hey, I'm only going to eat what I kill. But in return, you can't control me. So now that's a big, big deal. And so for me, things that are marketing activities, I don't have much control over. Like when somebody says, you know, give me your number, I say, okay, great, but may I have yours as well? And the reason why I want to have theirs is because I assume, and you might want to write this down, that all buyers are procrastinators. They may have every intent of calling me, but if I don't have their phone number, if I don't have a way of contacting them, I have no control over the situation. I have nothing I can do. I have to sit and I have to wait. And sitting and waiting is not being in sales. And so that's the first one, marketing as a cop-out to selling. So the second one to look at is, the reality is that there's a lack of job descriptions in the mortgage industry. And a lot of people look at their job as a result, and they confuse the result versus the actual job. And so, and the reality is also, this is a much worse problem than I think people realize, and it is widespread in the mortgage industry. And we look at this and say, okay, so what is your job? And most people will say, well, it's, you know, to close deals, or even worse, they're going to say, if you have loan officers or even real estate agents, they're going to say, well, it's to sell homes or to help my clients. Well, if your job was just to help clients, then why are you asking to get paid? Why don't you just do it for free? Well, the reality is you need to get paid. And so your job description is the list of activities that need to happen for you to for the sale to happen. It's not the end result or how many sales that you've made. And so when we look at selling homes as a result, it's not a job. And so the reality, when a home is sold, think of all of the steps that had to happen for that to happen. All of the pieces of the pie for your job. Now, I'm not talking about a processor. I'm talking about for you. And to identify where your job begins and where your job ends is another big piece around this job description. And we talked about in the first week the six money-making activities. If you don't remember those were prospecting, setting appointments, presenting value, closing a deal, aftercare and follow-up, and getting referrals. All of those six activities, that is your job description. And if you want to see that, make sure you go back to our webinar for the first week under professional selling. You'll see us go through that. And we even covered that in detail with Greg Frost when we broke down all six of those activities. And he gave us tangible things that we could walk away with that they're doing to implement all six of those activities. And so, again, make sure you go back and review those. So, again, lack of job description. So if you find yourself coming into the day and you don't know where or what you should be spending your time on, that is one of the biggest indicators of not knowing what your job description is, and really going back to what that sales process is. So what that ends up leading to is people become very, very busy, but they don't become productive. And so the third one is confusing activity with productivity. And I know that's a cliche because it's been so overused, but how often have you found yourself feeling busy but yet not making the money that you want to make, or not being as productive as you want to make? And so you have to ask yourself, and my closest friends and colleagues, and we very rarely allow ourselves to use the word busy, because the follow-up question is, okay, busy doing what? And the busy doing what? Are you happy and satisfied with the results you're getting? Then that's a good busy. If you're busy and you're not happy with the results, then maybe you should question what you're so busy doing. And so we look at this is also a direct result of number two, and not knowing what your job description. So if people don't know what their job is, then the reality is any opportunity can seem like a great way to spend time. There's a great analogy. Imagine yourself like a feather in the wind. When we don't have that clear focus, that clear goal of where we're headed, why we're doing things like that, you know, the winds of opportunity are going to blow you in every different direction. You're not going to know where it is you're going to go. And this is a harsh statement, but it's easy to look busy while still being broke. Think about that for a minute. And this is only something for you to answer. If you're a sales manager, you gotta look at all the metrics. How busy are they, but what are the results? And if they're busy with no results, that means they're busy doing the wrong things. If you're busy, you're not getting the results you want, you have to take a look at what are the activities that maybe I need to switch. How can I get re-engaged in the right activities going forward? So looking at confusing activity and productivity, what I would challenge you to do is take it to that next level and ask yourself those tough questions. Take a look at how you're spending your time. One of the things that I have people do is they take the six money-making activities and they take a green highlighter and a red highlighter. And you go back over your past month or your past week's activities and you highlight anything that was a money-making activity in green and anything that wasn't a money-making activity in red. And then you step back and you look at how much green versus red was there, and how well does that correlate with your income and productivity goals. So again, part of being a sales professional is about taking a good, honest look at the numbers, getting a good, honest look in the mirror, and saying, am I doing what I really need to be doing? So that would be number three, confusing activity with productivity. Number four, looking at no structured sales process. If you can imagine one, two, and three really combine up to this concept of a structured sales process. And if you know me, you know the importance of this. Every one of my clients, that's the first thing we talk about, is let's define your sales process. And I want to know what I mean by that is, how does a sale happen in your business, in your industry, at your company? Because each company is a little bit different. You know, how do you take something from a lead? And how do you even find the lead? And then what do you do with that lead? And how do you set an appointment? When are you getting in front of them to present a value? What are you saying as a presentation of value? How does that look? What does it sound like? Who are the best ones at it? Who's struggling with it? Are they saying the same things? What would happen if they said this? You know, if you really start to follow the anatomy of a sale and the process flow of a sale, you really start learning a lot about what's going on. And what's really exciting is if you watch the people who are already successful doing it. When you watch them, you start realizing that these guys aren't—they're not messing around. They're not winging it. They know exactly why they are there. So when you don't have one, it not only wastes your time, but more importantly, it also wastes your client's time. I can't tell you how many times. In fact, I was in a meeting earlier this week, and somebody was saying they had this big lead, and they were asking for some help. And I listened to it, and they said, "Well, they met somebody. They got a phone number at a certain event, and the person was an account rep." And they were making all these plans, and I said, hold on a second, let's identify this. What's your objective? What are you going to do with it? Well, we're going to set up a meeting and do a meet and greet. And okay, but what's the objective? What I read into instantly was this was going to begin to be a glorious waste of time for everybody unless they had a strategy of what they were going to do and how they were going to approach it. And when we look at the research, it shows that 80% of salespeople, they don't even understand what the primary purpose of their sales call is. And so we look at a structured sales process, it should not only outline the steps, but it should outline the goal of each of those steps. And that's what we call the commitment objective, if you remember that from our first session together. Having that clear commitment objective can cut your sales cycle time by 25%. And so what does that mean to you? By 25%, that equates to an extra 3 months of sales time without having to spend the sales time. So getting clear on your sales process, making sure that you have a clear commitment objective, and taking a look at how you are spending that time, how effectively you're spending that time, that's going to be one of the biggest keys to be successful in selling. And so let's take a look at the reality if you're new versus if you've been in the business. What I tell people who are new is you have to make up in numbers what you lack in skill. You have to make up in numbers what you lack in skill. If you're new at this, then do more of it. Somebody that sells 9 out of 10 versus somebody who sells 1 out of 10. How do you beat the person? If you're the one that sells 1 out of 10, how do you beat the person that sells 9? Well, when they talk to 10 people, they're going to sell 9 of them. But if you talk to 100, you'll sell 10. You got to out-hustle. Now, here's the cool factor. If you take the mentality of saying, fine, they sell 9 out of 10, I'm going to go out and present 100 times and I'll sell 10. By that 20th time, guess what's happening? You're getting better. You're not selling 1 out of 10 anymore. You're selling 2 out of 10. And maybe by that 30th time, you're selling 3 or maybe 4 out of 10. And if you really practice that often, and in that short a period of time, you'll be up to higher conversion ratios before you even know it. And so again, make up in numbers what you lack in skill if you're new. So number four, no structured sales process. Moving on to number five, no presentation of value. I can't tell you how many times I watch professional salespeople or want to be some professional salespeople walk in and they say they're going to wing it. And when I ask them, and I'm going to ask you right now, how many of you on this call right now have a prospectus or a presentation that you follow each time you meet with a client, each time you meet with a realtor or a financial advisor or any sort of referral partner? Just ask yourself how many of that. And I guarantee you that number is going to be a lot smaller than it is going to be larger. And so when we look at that reality of how many people are winging it when they get into that presentation, what that ends up meaning is that they're listening. Yeah, that's great. They probably trust themselves. They know the business well enough. But is it being as efficient as they could be? And in the article I wrote for the Resurgence of the Sales Professional, I talked about they don't have a canned presentation. And I use canned because I want it to be canned. I've given some of the same presentations hundreds of times, told the same stories, and it is canned, but it doesn't feel like it's canned, and that's the goal, and that only happens through practice. And so when we're looking at this, I've seen it too often, people go in unprepared, and they say something different each time. If you listen to the people and watch the people who are really good at what they do, they tend to say the same things, and the reason why, it's not because they're lazy. It's because they've done it so many times that they have found the most efficient way to communicate value. Again, one of your purposes or one of the things that I think defines a sales professional is your job is to communicate value. You are a communicator of value. And if you've done it enough, you'll find that there are certain phrases or certain timings or certain sequences that just tend to work better. And if you knew that worked better, then why wouldn't you use it? If you knew the client got more value out of that phrase, then why wouldn't you use it? If you knew that this sequence saved people more money, why wouldn't you use it? And so don't be afraid of having a canned presentation. Don't be afraid of something that is practiced. Of course, what you're probably more afraid of is sounding like it's canned. Well, the only way through that is through practice and repetition. You have to keep going, and you cannot depend on your ability to talk to save you from this one. Guarantee you can't depend on it. And you know what? The reality is there are some people that are so good at this and they can talk their way in and out of everything. But even those people, they have a canned presentation in their mind. They draw upon some of the same stories, the same sequences. And so I believe that every successful salesperson that I know, at least, has perfected their scripting and their presentation. You should gravitate towards scripting, not gravitate away from it. Learn that there's a reason for why those words are put in that sequence. Test it, practice it, ask people why it's working for them. Have those same people listen to you, because maybe you try and it didn't work, but maybe there's just a little thing that you're doing wrong, or maybe it's a piece of voice inflection or timing, you're not waiting, or you skipped over an important piece. But get the feedback and make sure you practice that presentation. And I believe that the true sales professional can deliver his or her presentation on a napkin just as well as using a PowerPoint. My favorite presentation of value, because I tell people you got to have three. You got to have it on a PowerPoint. It's something on the computer that you can walk people through that has professionally designed pieces for the right time. You have to have it on a prospectus, something where computer and technology is not available and you need visuals. But the most powerful of all the presentations of value, in my opinion, is a napkin. And the reason why, imagine yourself sitting at a dinner and somebody asks you what you do. And you say, well, thank you. And you pull out your iPad and you start flipping through a presentation. Instantly, the resistance is going to go up. They're going to feel extremely violated. They're going to feel like it was inappropriate. It's not going to be fun for anyone. Well, okay, let's try the prospectus. And they say, well, so what do you do? And you pull out a brochure and a prospectus and you start flipping through that. Instantly, they're probably going to think you're network marketing or something that it just seems completely inappropriate. But if they ask you what you do and you say, well, here, let me grab a napkin. And you grab a napkin and you draw a couple circles and you draw a grid and you say, well, this is kind of how we look at our business and I remember getting started this way. And you draw just a little picture. You're going to watch that they're intrigued. They're going to lean forward. They might even ask you. In fact, I can't tell you how many times people have taken the napkin home with them after I've drawn on it. There's a certain restaurant here in Minneapolis that I love to go to because the entire tablecloth was a big sheet of paper. And the waitress would come by and she'd draw her name on that sheet of paper and we'd have crayons and markers and I'd be drawing pictures of the brain, I'd be drawing pictures of the sales process, they'd be grabbing the marker, drawing on top of it, and by the end the client is taking that picture home with them. And if they take that picture home, that means they're intrigued. So make sure you understand how to deliver what it is that you're delivering in every way possible. And if you don't have a napkin, then learn to speak with pictures. Learn to draw with your mind. And if you learn to draw with your mind, you also have to realize you have to give the person the ability to think for a minute. Now, if you can imagine yourself right now sitting at a table and presenting to somebody, now, even just how I'm speaking right now, imagine yourself sitting at a table, you're standing up, you've got three people in the room. I'm speaking in a way that allows your brain to paint a picture. And I'm also speaking in a sequence or in a timing or a cadence that allows your brain to draw that picture. If you speak too fast and you start telling people what to do and all that sort of stuff, they're not going to get it. You have to slow down and have that strong way of speaking and that strong presentation style. But the ultimate goal of having that canned presentation is to make it sound and feel natural. That's only going to happen through presentation or through practice over and over and over again. So, next, number six, no training in the fundamentals of selling. This one blew my mind because I started learning the fundamentals. I started learning about hot buttons at the time that I learned it, it was the 5 money making activities. We learned about silence after closing and asking for the sale. We learned about all of it. And for some reason, when I started in the mortgage industry, is that nobody was teaching selling. That's one of the reasons why I called Greg Frost, because he also came from a direct sales background, and he brought that salesmanship to the mortgage industry. And so we're looking at sales training. We're looking at really the first thing that I noticed years ago. And I, like I said before, I believe the refi boom killed the sales profession within mortgage. And the reason it did is because it made getting deals too easy. And everybody forgot that there was a value-adding portion of it. And so people saw easy money. They saw no barrier to entry. And they knew people that needed mortgage. So they got in, they got overpaid, and made a ton of money. And that was one of the saddest things that happened. And I can't tell you how many conversations I've had where people say, you know what, Rene, you're absolutely right. I got to go back to what got me here. I got to go back to who it was that made me successful. And then every once in a while, I remember running into somebody who says, well, you know, Rene, I made $250,000 in the refi boom, so I must be a sales professional. And my response was very, very real and very honest. And the truth is, a lot of people made $250,000 back then. And what I knew is the sales professionals, they made somewhere of $700,000 to $1 million during that time. And I know many people right now that are doing those kinds of numbers right now because they sell. They've got great marketing. They've got great teams. But they also never forget that they are selling. And we're going to go into this next piece, and you hear me say selling and selling and selling, which leads us into the last one, the second to last one, but I think it's at the core of what the toughest one. And if you're having a hard time when I'm saying selling, maybe number 7 is where your struggle is that there's a shame to be a salesperson. Unfortunately, this industry teaches people how to persuade. It teaches them psychology. The psychology of persuasion, influence. And then, of course, the word manipulation comes into play. Manipulation, in my definition, is defined as influence or persuasion to an extreme, where it's to benefit one and not another. It's persuasion and manipulation to an extreme, where one person benefits and the other one doesn't. And so there's nothing wrong with influence. And anybody says they don't like to influence would lie to you about other things as well. Every female I've met, every male that I've met, everybody that I know uses influence because they influence people to think a certain way, to go to a certain restaurant, watch a different movie, influence their kids to brush their teeth. Everybody influences and influences persuasion. And if you're in sales and you're ashamed of this, we got to begin here. And a lot of times I'll begin and I'll ask people, I say, well, tell me about what do you think about a car salesman? And just for a minute, what words come to mind when I say car salesman and salesperson? And most oftentimes, and I'll write it on a sheet of paper, shyster, liar, greedy, all sorts of really, really harsh words. And we'll get them all out. We'll have a great time, and they're kind of laughing along. And I said, and then I'll look at them, and I say, now here's the reality. I think about very different things when I think of a car salesperson. I think of somebody who's a hustler. And somebody means to get up every day, they're going to eat what they kill. I think of somebody who's taken on the ability to offer and deliver value. But the reality is that most of the time when we describe a car salesperson, we're often describing how we really feel about the sales profession. And that's why you see so many people change their titles to consultants or, there's so many different client care or client manager, experience manager. But they're really salespeople. They're going to sell something to guide people through a process. But when they change that, it's an indicator that they're ashamed of the profession. And if they're ashamed of the profession, then anything that has to do with the profession, they're not going to engage in. Think about that for just a minute. When we look at people who are ashamed of being salespeople, they don't engage in the habits of successful salespeople, such as closing, driving commitment, countering objections, and prospecting. If being a salesperson is described in your mind or you feel it that way, you're going to avoid all of the activities, all of the habits, all of the things that get you to be a successful person in this arena. And so if, and I'm not saying it is, but if this is one of those areas that you struggle with, I suggest you start really facing that one. And to me, I look at the reality of loving this profession. It is one of the, in business, nothing happens until something is sold. If nothing sells, there is no business. the economy is starving without us out there pushing and driving and making money move from one hand to another by offering value in exchange of that. It's a beautiful thing. And I can't tell you how many times that I've sold something and somebody came up to me saying, thank you so much, because had you not explained it that way, I would have never known. Think of the people that are selling solutions to problems, solutions to cancer, solutions to things that somebody has to sell that idea. And unfortunately, there's a lot of people out there, at least in the past, that abused of that and made it a pretty bad name. And so when we're looking at that, this shame piece also comes back to the last one here, which I'm going to talk about, is where you ignore your online reputation. This one's a new one, because when I first wrote this article, there really wasn't the online reputation piece. I wrote this back in 2009, I believe, maybe even earlier. No, it might have been 07 when I wrote this. And when we look at that, the reality of today when we're being ashamed is because of a lot of things that people are saying about the industry or what they're saying about sales professionals. But when we look at what it takes to be a sales professional and what it takes to be a professional in anything, right now 85% of people, if they're going to do business with you, they're going to look online first. They're going to look who you are, where you work, what people are saying about you. Think about what you do when you want to go to a hotel in a new city. You go online and you look at reviews. Think about when you want to buy a new product. What do? You want to buy a new TV. What are people saying about this TV? What are people saying about this movie? What's the ratings of the movie? How many Rotten Tomatoes did it get? What was Rotten Tomatoes saying? I mean, it's happening all over the place. And now, because it's time, it's happening now in the mortgage and real estate industry. So the big question is, what are they saying about you? And I know I've spoken to a lot of people that they said they've made the mistake of building this great business around referrals and building this great energy and network around people, but they forgot what it takes to take that same energy online and what people are saying about them. And so when we think about what's at the core of the online reputation, that's where Better Loan Officers comes into play. And that's why we built BetterLoanOfficers.com. And so as I transition here and going into this piece, I want to also open this up for opens up for questions. So Brian, I'm going to ask you to start kind of moseying back in here, see if you can help me field some questions. But we just covered a lot of topics in terms of from sales to all of the eight pieces, online reputation. And so what I'd love to do is be able to open this back up to you guys. And again, if I don't hear anything, I'm just going to keep moving forward and describing BetterLoanOfficers.com. Again, if there are any questions, please raise your hand, and we can also unmute you. I always prefer the conversation that we can hear your voice and we can talk about it. But how do we apply how do we apply these in different parts of your business? Maybe something you want to talk about. So again, I'm going to keep an eye out for that. And Brian, also please help me keep an eye out for that.
You bet.
So one of the things that we've been asking is that for those of you that are on these calls, if you're getting value out of it, one of the things we'd like to ask you to do is to go on and claim your profile. And when you go to BetterLoanOfficers.com, there's a button up at the top corner that says For Loan Officers. If you click that, it'll take you to this page here where you can enter your NMLS number to claim your free profile. And it is free. And what we're going to do here, and Brian, I'll be sending you the link to this as well. If you found value out of today, I did put together a CD series called The Resurgence of the Sales Professional. We're going into detail about the story and a lot of these different pieces. For those of you who just claim your free profile, it's not something you have to pay for, you go in and claim it and send us an email. We will send back an email to you with a link to download the Resurgence of Sales Professional CD. I'll go into the six money-making activities in detail, the story in detail, and a lot of different sales professional pieces. A lot of people have come back and have said it's one of the best sales CDs they've ever heard, which is great. I only say that because I'm telling you there's a lot of really good content on there. And so again, if you go to BetterLoanOfficers.com and you click For Loan Officers, claim your profile, and your profile should have this little banner on it that says unclaimed here. When you click claim, it'll walk you through just a couple of different pieces. You just got to make sure that you enter your email and password, because we already have the rest of your information, NMLS ID, etc. And then register it and then send us an email. And Brian, what email do you want them to send that to? Let's see if he's on here.
Sorry, I was on mute. They can send it to me. They can send it to me directly, Brian, B-R-I-A-N, at BetterLoanOfficers.com, or support at BetterLoanOfficers.com.
So I'm just going to type it here. And then, Brian, for those that want to sign up for a professional subscription, we have a code for them as well. What is that code?
Yes, we do. The promotion code, or the discount code, is ETHOSPRO30. All capital letters. Capital ETHOSPRO30.
And perfect. That'll give them 30% off, correct?
Correct.
So that's about $100 off the $294 yearly price, correct?
Correct. Yep.
Beautiful. So, again, go to BetterLoanOfficers.com, enter that code, claim your profile, and we'll send you the free, if you send an email to Brian at BetterLoanOfficers.com or support at BetterLoanOfficers.com, we'll send you that free link to download the audio. And I'm sure, Brian, we'll get up a page where people can also click, and we'll probably just send you out the link to where people can just click on it. Again, then also, if you do see that you want to upgrade, because there's a ton of really cool stuff on BetterLoanOfficers.com for being a professional member, to upgrade to that Ethos Pro, to being Ethos Verified, a professional membership. And Cynthia's asking, what's the cost to join? It's $294 per year minus the 30%, which is right around $98 or something like that to join. Now, again, I'll give you an example of what some of it looks like here. I don't always plan on going through this, but I get a lot of questions, and so people are asking. In essence, what Better Loan Officers is, it's a way for you to gather your online reviews. So when you get there, you're be rated in the areas of communication, responsiveness, cost, fees, accuracy, turnaround, and overall experience. And so this becomes a very strong marketing tool for building your reputation, as well as gathering testimonials. And so when you see your profile is going to look something like this, and you'll see that you have a place here where real estate agents review you and consumers review you, and it's really a beautiful repository of your testimonials. They're going to have a way to get a hold of you via all the social media outlets, as well as buttons like apply for a loan, download pro sheet, and things like that. In fact, I think I'm just going to pull one up here as we go. I'll just pull it up there. But Cynthia, does that answer your question? All right, perfect. So, again, I'll just look up someone's. Let's look up Tyler. We always like Tyler because he's done such a good job with his. Perfect. So we did answer your question, Cynthia. So when you do search, you'll find that. I didn't spell his name right. That's why. But that's what it looks like right here when somebody is unclaimed. If I can learn to spell, that'd be good. Are the testimonials, what does that say? From Aubrey. Are the testimonials solicited by past clients, realtors, or is this search and repost of what has been said online about you? This is something that you use to solicit from your past clients, realtors. So this is something you control. So let's take a look at Tyler. He's got over 70 reviews on here. In fact, Tyler's one of the most reviewed loan officer in all of Iowa, not only on our site, but on almost every other site. He has built a business around his online reputation. It's just an excellent job. And so this is what it looks like here. You'll see that he's got all his reviews here. You can follow him here. He's got an apply for a loan button that's there. None of the other sites have custom links like this where you can really customize it to how you run your business, where you can leave a review, and his pro sheet is very powerful. This is where we take all of his assets, and we want to design something beautiful that he can use as a referral document. So this takes his reviews, what people have said about him, his headshot. It's third-party endorsed by Better Loan Officers. It also shows his on-time closing percentage, because we asked the question of, did your loan close on time, and has these beautiful raving reviews about who he is and what he's done. Imagine if one of your realtors handed out two business cards and this. So here are two loan officers, and here's Tyler. You choose who you think is best. This is one of those documents that a lot of our people are going and printing off and putting in their referral partners' desks, saying, hey, when you want to use this, when you want to refer me, just hand them this document. They've got all my contact information and everything that they need here. So very, very powerful tool that you get as a part of being a professional member. Also, what you'll see here under the information section, because we know that there's a lot of review sites out there, is that Tyler has direct links to all of his other review sites, so you can see how, what people are saying about him on all of these other sites there. He's also really leveraged the custom resource links, where these are the links that he uses for a lot of his and how he runs his business, of course, his website, email address, everything. So very powerful. This is, you get a lot of these, you get the reviews and everything, being a free member, things like the pro sheet and apply for a loan, those are being part of being a pro member, but there's still a lot of value in being a free member. So next question says, our bank has a system that generates a survey after every closing that is sent to the agents and borrowers. Is there a way to take those surveys, get back input back into BetterLoanOfficers.com instead of soliciting another review? So here's what a lot of people are doing. Because every system uses a different rating system, we don't import those, but Rhonda, one of the things that we have our clients do is when you go to this leave review piece here, this is Tyler's link right there, if you look up in the bottom left-hand corner. So what people are doing is including that link in their survey process. In fact, our next version is also going to have a survey builder built within it, so you can custom whatever surveys you want to have in there. What a lot of people have found is that the surveys that they're sending out, you're getting all this great information, but it's stuck either on a sheet of paper or it's stuck on a spreadsheet somewhere, and it's nowhere to be found online. And so you can't leverage it. You're not getting any Google representation. You're not getting any way of somebody finding you. And so they're moving over to a system like this where they get their ratings here, and they also capture the reviews that are there. And so, Ron, if you look up your NMLS piece, you'll have, just claim the free profile, and you'll have this review link that is all yours that you can include in on that survey. So it just really requires them to add that piece when yours are sent out. Does that answer your question, Rhonda? Perfect. Thank you. So again, a lot of really cool stuff that happens within this, and if you have any questions or anything like that, you know, you feel free to contact me at Rene@BetterLoanOfficers.com or Brian as well at BetterLoanOfficers.com. So if it looks like we got another question. Cynthia, is your system allowing to market to realtors? So let me log in and show you what we have for from a marketing perspective here. In terms of, do we allow to market? So we have marketing tools. I have to apologize. I'm a bad multitasker here. I can't spell and talk at the same time. And I can't type and talk. Let's see if I did it right. I'll show you the back end and what it looks like and the marketing tools. So, yes, we do have lots of marketing tools that are available. Impersonate real quick. All right, so this is what it looks like when you're logged into the system. You have at the top this button here that says Marketing Tools. And under Marketing Tools, you have Profile Tools as well as Review Tools. So this is the tools to manage your profile, where you can put in your the link to your own custom online web app. These are the custom resource links, as well as we allow you to share your link to your profile via all of these social media tools, so, you know, Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, Google, or even email. And when you click the email, it has a pre-custom language that it throws in there for you. You can also embed your profile into your own personal website here. So you take this code, give it to your developer, and they just put it in there, and it shows up, your profile shows up on your website. And so when it comes to getting reviews, you've got, you can ask for a review via these sites here as well. And then we also automate, when somebody sends you a review or gives you a review that's 4 stars and above, it will automatically post to Twitter or LinkedIn if you link it together. Now, what's really cool, too, is when you become a pro member, you're going to get 2 profiles, one that's located on BetterLoanOfficers.com and another one that's located on MyMortgagePage.com. And the difference between the two is, I'll show you, on BetterLoanOfficers.com, this is what it's going to look like. You're going to see all of our branding, Better Loan Officers stuff here. But the challenge is that somebody then can go ahead and click the search button and see who else is in your area and search out your competitors. By being a pro member, you also get this version, which is the unbranded site. So if you see there's no Better Loan Officers logo, you're on mymortgagepage.com, so they, you know, whoever the person is assumes that it's your page, and they're not going to go anywhere. They're staying focused just on you. Let's see, we got another question, and Cynthia, does that answer your question? What about negative reviews? Great question. So let's take a look at that for a minute. Going back to his profile. When we are the only system, because we know right now something like 30% of Yelp reviews are fake. We also know that there are people out there that can, you know, go to Fiverr.com and hire people to go out and send reviews. We are the only button, the only service that allows this button here, if you can see it, says dispute. And disputing a review takes the review down and puts it into a dispute resolution process. So if the person cannot prove that they are verified, plus every review that's left, people have to be verified. They're as verified as they would be on Facebook. But when they click that button, it sends them to the dispute resolution process. What we also allow is the reply to a review. So a lot of times people will say things that really were, they'll say things that weren't the loan officer's fault. This gives the loan officer a chance to, you know, say, you know, I'm sorry that sorry you had that experience. And, you know, if you recall, this is what happened. You know, please give us a call directly, or, you know, whatever it is, it shows transparency. So, again, we're giving control back to the loan officer and transparency so that you people get a chance to see how you respond. People are more concerned with how a company responds to an issue versus what the client says about the issue. Think about if you've ever been to a steakhouse and the steak's been overdone and had a horrible experience, but they come back and they take care of it. Then maybe they comp the meal. They give you a gift certificate. They really go out of their way. The chef comes out and apologizes. They bring you a free dessert. And they really go over the top. It really turns it into a fantastic experience. And it wasn't about the fact that the steak was bad. It was about how they took care of it afterwards. And that's what we wanted to create with this ability to reply to a review. Cynthia, does that answer both your questions there? And see if there's any more as we're waiting there. Perfect. She said yes. Well, we're getting right to the end here. If we don't have any more questions, again, please go and claim your profile. That's going to be the big piece, and you'll get the downloaded version of not just today's piece, but also you'll get the downloadable audio of Resurgence of the Sales Professional. And remember, if you have any questions, once you claim your profile, send an email to brian@betterloanofficers.com. And if you do upgrade, use the Ethos Pro 30 to get that 30% off. If we don't have any more questions, I will let you guys go just a few minutes early. And again, we're doing this every Thursday, same time. Next month is going to be a different topic. We're going to have a lot of fun. And please tell people that you work with, tell anybody that you work with, have them join on and spread the love. Again, this is Rene Rodriguez, BetterLoanOfficers.com, and you've been a part of the Better 52 webinar series. We'll see you next time.